Hello everyone, welcome to Tutorials by Ayushi. So this is the fourth video of the course of photosynthesis. In the previous videos, I've already talked about difference between light reaction and dark reaction, of how assimilatory powers in form of ATP and reducing powers in form of NADPH2 is formed in light reaction, and those assimilatory powers are further required and used in dark reaction in Kelvin cycles to actually produce glucose or sugars. So in the previous videos, I've already talked about light and its absorption and excitation of chlorophyll by light, and in the previous video I covered the three topics, which is evolution of oxygen, red drop emulsion effect and pigments effect. Also, if you haven't watched the video yet, I would request you to please go back and watch the following videos, because there are many concepts involved in the previous videos which actually involves the first processes which takes place in light reaction in the formation of assimilatory powers in form of ATP and NADPH2. Now, what actually happens in non-cyclic and cyclic photophosphorylation? How are these two photochemical processes important in light reaction? What are the various processes? What are the various procedures and steps that are involved in non-cyclic and cyclic photophosphorylation is what I'm going to talk about in this video and in the coming video. Now, what is the importance of cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphorylation? How does it take place, and what are the byproducts of photophosphorylation process? Why is it required by plants? Now, in the previous videos, I've already talked that the main products that are being formed in light reaction is the assimilatory powers in form of ATP and reducing powers in form of NADPH2. Now, if you get my point that the main products that are being formed are ATP and NADPH2. Therefore, the main important step or the main important thing that cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphorylation does is the preparation of the assimilatory powers ATP and the reducing powers NADPH2. So before starting non-cyclic photophosphorylation, first I'll be talking about cyclic photophosphorylation. Now, starting up with cyclic photophosphorylation first, before starting this, I would like to clear up the concept that the main product or the main product that we require from cyclic photophosphorylation process is ATP, that is assimilatory powers that can further be transferred to dark reaction for the preparation of sugars or glucose. Now, starting up with cyclic photophosphorylation, what happens in cyclic photophosphorylation? There is involvement of only one photosystem, which is photosystem 1, which has a reaction center P700. Now, if you remember, in my previous videos, I've already talked about the structure of the pigment molecules or chlorophyll molecules. So if you haven't watched the video, please do go back and watch the video which consists of excitation of chlorophyll by light, which is the first part of light reaction video. Now, also, if you haven't watched the video, I would just clear a slight concept here, is that the pigment molecules or chlorophyll molecules consist of very small photosynthetic units. Now, within this photosynthetic unit, each photosynthetic unit has a reaction center in between it, which is further being covered up by light harvesting complex. Now, since in cyclic photophosphorylation, only one photosystem is required with only one reaction center, which means that in the pigment molecules or in chlorophyll molecules within the photosynthetic unit, the reaction center involved is of P700 nanometer, and there is only one pigment molecule involved, which is photosystem 1. So I hope this concept is clear with you, that in cyclic photophosphorylation, photosystem 1 is used, or the pigment molecules used is of photosystem 1, and the reaction center involved is P700 nanometer. Now, if you remember the first step that happens in light reaction is that a quantum of light or a photon of light come and strike the pigment molecules or the photosystem. Now here, when light comes and strike the photosystem 1, the electrons present in the photosystem 1 or P700 are excited. And once they are excited, they are being transferred to the first electron acceptor, which is FES. Now also do remember the fact that since photosystem 1 or P700 reaction center is losing electron, therefore it gets oxidized. It is getting oxidized because it is losing electron. And also do remember the fact that each electron acceptor in the cyclic photophosphorylation process, before accepting the electrons, are placed in oxidized state. And when they are being placed in oxidized state, only then they accept electrons from the preceding electron acceptor. So once the electrons are excited and it is being received by FES, then further FES, the electrons are being transferred from FES to plastocyanin through various electron acceptors including ferredoxin, plastoquinone, cytochrome V6 F complex, and then at the last it transfers to plastocyanin. Now through this series of electron acceptors, when the electrons are being transferred back to plastocyanin, the plastocyanin molecule, it transfers back the electrons to P700 reaction center or photosystem 1. Why? Because this reaction center present is in oxidized state, because it has already lost its electron and turned into oxidized state. And since it is in in its oxidized state, plastoquinone can easily transfer its electron to photosystem 1. And since the electrons which started up from photosystem 1 comes back to it via transferring and traveling through various electron acceptors, this process is known as cyclic photophosphorylation. Now I've already talked that what happens in cyclic or non-cyclic photophosphorylation is that assimilatory powers in form of ATP is produced. So when the electrons are transferring through the various electron acceptors, how is ATP formed is the question. Now the ATP is formed by this process which I'm going to tell now. When the electrons are transferred from one electron acceptor to the other electron acceptors, what happens is that when the electrons are being transferred, then energy is released. Now this energy released is in form of chemical energy, and the chemical energy is further converted into ATP by plants. Now this is what the plants do, that they convert the chemical energy that is released by the transfer of electrons and save that energy in form of ATP. So this is how ATP is being formed in cyclic photophosphorylation. So I hope you're clear up with the process of cyclic photophosphorylation. Please do follow up the second video as well, in which I'll be talking about non-cyclic photophosphorylation, which again is a very important process to understand and usually comes out to be a very hesitant factor to learn amongst students. So please do follow up the next video in which I'll be talking about non-cyclic photophosphorylation, and I hope you're clear up with the concept of cyclic photophosphorylation in this video. If you like the video, please do follow me on the application. Also do share this video with your friends and keep studying.